I recently discovered this footage of one of my favourite French hip-hop crews of the late 90s. And it made me realise, despite making some of the most innovative hip-hop of the time, most rap fans outside of France have never heard of them. So who were they? And why are they, in my opinion, so underappreciated? The group is Cyan Supercrew, and in this video, I want to get into the history of the group, as well as what made them so unique. From way ahead of their time rhyming skills, to their pioneering use of beatbox. From genre blending beats, to their energetic live shows. And perhaps unpack a little bit about why their legacy has been somewhat overlooked in the current rap music landscape. Let's get into it. Cyan Supercrew formed in the autumn of 1997 as a collective of three existing rap crews, namely Fefe, KLR and later Vicelo of OFX, Leroy and Spectre from Explicit Samurai, and Sly the Mike Buddha and Sir Samuel, aka Simple Spirit. These individual crews were beginning to make a name for themselves in the Paris hip-hop scene. For example, Leroy had appeared on compilations and featured on the Mafia Tresse album. And KLR and Fefe, still under his original moniker of Phoenix, had put out their first single as OFX. That was produced by DJ Fun in 1996. At the time, he was running Nomad Studios out of a rented basement in the Stalingrad district of Paris, and it was here that all these talented MCs would cross paths. The first record out of Nomad to include them all together is a rare double A-side cassette from 97 called Arbus de Confiance, Killer Instinct, produced by DJ Follow. The track listing actually credits everyone separately here, but the idea to form one group must have already happened because it's name-checked throughout. The recording's clearly rough, but even at this early stage, you can hear all the vocal creativity that would become a signature of the Cyan Supercrew sound. And it's a great listen for fans too, who will recognise early versions of verses that found their way onto later songs. It wasn't long before they recorded their first tracks together, officially as Cyan Supercrew, and the resulting EP was Cyan Superland, released independently in 1998. The beats are classic boom bap, but the tonal range and the various vocal styles of the seven-man lineup totally set them apart from everyone else. But an untimely tragedy would threaten to end their career before it began. In April 1998, one of the members, KLR, died in a car accident. It was a huge blow. The group was going to disband, recalled Vicelo. But in the end, it made us more determined to make it. With renewed perspective and motivation, Cyan Supercrew began hitting stages all over France, and their innovative live shows impressed audiences wherever they performed. They had choreographed movements, they had beatbox, they even had little stage tricks like turning up the volume and performing tracks backwards. As one music journalist wrote after seeing them for the first time, it was a crazy slap in the face. They did things I'd never seen, like interrupting songs to mime a coin falling. And eventually, it all paid off. Record labels began to take notice, and the group signed a deal with Source in 1999. Cyan Supercrew were on a mission to create something new, something out of the ordinary, and the albums that followed would attempt to capture the essence of hip-hop and push the art of rap to its limits. Where do I start? I think the thing that really jumps out at you when you first listen to Cyan Supercrew is how completely unique the rap style is. The flows are just next level. This is perfectly demonstrated on their first studio album, KLR. Released in October 1999 and named in tribute to their former member, check out how each MC comes in on this track, Darkness. Tête basse, basse, poche pleine de crasse, ouais. Il n'y peut rien, mais c'est comme un rat, évidemment. Non, fallait qu'il prenne, prenne les devants, tout lui rentre dedans.
Situation complexe, sa complice, sa couple avec son compère. La jeu s'est fait dans une lettre où la dernière phrase était vois-tu pas le temps qu'on perd.
Super interesting flows in and of themselves, but also the conventional approach of taking turns to do 16 bars, that's out the window. Instead, it's rapid fire, multi-layered vocals with ad-libs coming in from all directions. Pick any song and expectations are subverted in favor of frenetic, unpredictable vocal work. And apart from the amazing delivery and the rhyme schemes, they're playing with the words too, the sounds of syllables, using alliteration, plosives, like every technique under the sun. Honestly, these guys could rap the alphabet and make it sound good. In fact, they did do that. Another thing you might notice is how rich and varied the tones and textures are, mainly because the voices of each MC are so distinctive from one another, from the low register of V-Solo to Spectre at the opposite end. So Samuel bringing that smooth melodic element with Sly the Mike Buddha on beatbox and characters. What can I say about Fefe's mind-boggling flow? Or Leroy, who switches from regular raps to his trademark multi-tracked parts. Musicality is a huge part of the Science Supercrew sound. They pack the verses full of little melodic lines that are so catchy that I reckon if anyone else had come up with them, they'd have used them as the main hook. But this allows for more complex, layered choruses. And whilst we're on the subject of musicality, one of the things that Science Supercrew are perhaps best known for is how their albums span multiple genres. KLR, for example, goes from straight-ahead boom-bap tunes like J'adore ça to R&B slow jams to reggae numbers to acoustic guitar songs and afro beats, which brings us to Angela. Let's talk about Angela. This song was a blessing and a curse for Science Supercrew. The song is by far and away their biggest hit, perhaps their only hit. And it's not hip-hop really, it's more of a cheeky zouk rhythm, but it blew up. Pop audiences started tuning in, and diehard rap fans started tuning out. Which is especially unfair now, given how the song has completely taken on a life of its own. Let me play the intro, and you'll see what I mean. That little beatbox intro was sampled by J Balvin for his colossal hit Amarillo in 2020. Racking up 180 million YouTube views and 340 million plays on Spotify. And to add insult to injury, now it's been covered by some of France's biggest artists. It's a great success. Angela, appelle-moi ce soir. J'suis dans l'banks, j'ai pas quitté l'four. With, by the way, no writer's credit given to Science Supercrew. Today, this song is the soundtrack to TikToks the world over, but only a fraction of those users actually know its true origin. Imagine, in 1999, you receive confused shrugs for rapping over Afrobeats. Then 20 years later, it's the biggest music genre on the planet. It's bad enough that their success at the time hasn't translated into global recognition today. But back then, that same success was overshadowing their credibility as hip-hop artists. It's not surprising then that their second album, X-Ray Zone, keeps to a more hip-hop-focused sound. Released in 2001, it still retains the creativity and inventiveness of the previous records, but it's more mature. The title track is an absolute banger with buttery smooth flows from every rapper. Also gone are the quirky videos of KLR in favour of slick studio visuals. The production levels up with this album too. There's some serious crate digging on display, from obscure piano samples
14-02-2-0-0-2, la Saint-Valentin qui dit.
Or little jazz references in the beatbox. And for the track Soldat 2, producers Mark Landers and Curtis Newton, aka Le Bloc, flip a tune from a 1970s blaxploitation vampire flick. Gonna get together in the inner. Here's the beat they made from it. Some of those chops would make Dilla proud. And don't forget, this is before Champion Sound and Donuts even came out. Also, shout out to Leroy here, who fires in with four bars made up entirely of a single word rhyme scheme. Que tant de clans se vantent devant le temple, se prend, pense, ton même plan se vend, en même temps sans se rendre. When X-Rayzone was released, there was actually an attempt to break out internationally. The X-Rayzone international version had them collab with some amazing artists, Roots Maneuver, The Arsonist, Brand Nubian. They even did a tune with RZA and Ghostface from Wu-Tang. However, just as recognition outside of France seemed to be on the cards, dynamics within the group were beginning to break down. Spectre left due to artistic differences, and internal tensions led to solo projects. Roots by OFX and Rap by Explicit Samurai, both really great albums. Cyan Supercrew's last record was Hold Up, released in 2005. And though it's a great album, ironically it doesn't hold up as well as the others. It really leans into their huge range of musical influences, from the beautiful acoustics of Rue Sang. Je suis là sans linge. Là à prier le père de l'ange pour que ne plus jamais les corps s'allongent. To the reggae tinge 96 Degrees. Je me déplace, je calme les choses rapidement, je fais diversion, exécutant le droit, pas de danse. And whilst the hip-hop tunes are there, it goes much further into pop territory. And after extensive touring to promote it, Cyan Supercrew called it quits in 2007. So what's happened since? Each MC from the group has gone on to forge solo careers in the years after Cyan Supercrew. Spectre has done some intermittent features and releases over the years. Sir Samuel has been making reggae albums and most recently Afrobeats tunes. Sly the Mike Buddha continued with the beatboxing he was known for in Cyan and has since transitioned into soul music as Sly Johnson. Vicelo consistently put out solo tunes and collabs, including touring with Spectre and Sir Samuel in the late 2010s. He's since become an artist, coach and manager. Leroy has been solidly working on collabs, mixtapes and full-length projects over the years. Recently, he and Fefe teamed up, touring and releasing an album under the name 365 Days, with some very questionable fashion choices. And as for Fefe himself, he was successful taking on a more pop sound, but still retained all his technical excellence. I love his tune OC4 from 2017, which has a brilliant music video which he directed. He's putting out brand new music to this day, which is well worth checking out. So, the big question. Why don't people think about Cyan Supercrew in the history of hip-hop, given their musical contribution to the genre? Well, number one, the language. It pains me to think that if this group was American, like all the same flows, style, rhyme schemes, but in English, the whole world would have realized just how good they were. As Accelerator put it, the West's limited patience with non-English language music has kept them off the radar and from becoming the world-renowned hip-hop royalty their talent merits. Don't forget, in the late 90s, early 2000s, even English language rap that wasn't American was confined to the underground, so French rap would have struggled to find an international market back then. Number two, the era. When Cyan Supercrew started in 1997, the American boom bap or golden era style of hip-hop reigned supreme. Simple flows about street life over moody piano and string samples was the dominant sound. And this was the same in France too. Most of the celebrated classics of French hip-hop follow this format. Clearly, Cyan sounded very different, and it didn't always land with audiences at the time. Even if we think about more experimental hip-hop, like the stuff on the Definitive Jux label, they didn't start putting out records until after Cyan's first album, so truly they were ahead of the curve. Number three, the mix of genres. As I touched on earlier, their biggest hit, Angela, does not fit into a hip-hop category. I've spoken to many French rap fans who just don't see Cyan as hip-hop at all. And sure, Zouk, Afrobeats, dancehall, reggae, electro, there's a lot of different genres going on here that maybe your average rap fan back in the day just wasn't into. I think if they were around today though, audiences would be much more accustomed to various musical influences in rap. And lastly, the vibe. For many people, their musical style, their appearance, it was just too light. And it's true, they were fun and playful, and maybe not hip-hop in a conventional sense. Their first videos probably don't do them any favours either. I mean, what is this? Are they out on a hike, making tea in a caravan? I mean, to be honest, this would be kind of sick now, but I just don't think people were ready for that yet. Again, comparable, positive vibe backpacker crews in the US, groups like Jurassic 5, weren't known yet. They only released their first album, coincidentally, in the same month as Cyan Supercrew's first EP dropped. And for those who would write off Cyan as not being serious enough, I'd point to tunes like Le Preuve Pas Trois and JD, like the social commentary that rap fans expected from other French groups like I Am. It was there in Cyan Supercrew, if not quite to the same extent. Fortunately today, we live in a much more connected world, where artists from all over the world can find an audience anywhere. In recent years, there's been more of a spotlight on Cyan Supercrew due to Angela's sampling and, for the 25th anniversary of KLR, Vicelo, Spectre, Sir Samuel and Sly Johnson will reform for a one-off tour, the Cyan Super Celebration, and have released loads of great new video clips for fans. So perhaps time will tell on this one. Either way, those of us who've discovered them along the way, beyond French-speaking countries, recognise just how worthy they are to be considered not only amongst the OGs of French rap, but also important in the history of hip-hop worldwide. This channel supports my online radio project, Transport Radio, streaming lesser-known music from around the world over at transportradio.live. We're on Mixcloud, Soundcloud and Instagram too, and subscribe here for more untold stories in music. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you next time.